Hey nerds, I'm EmceeProphIt. The government is still shut down. I'm moving across the entire country in a few days. I've been living in a half-broken house ever since the hurricane hit. I have a massive migraine, and I'll be honest, I can't really be fucked right now. Honesty is a virtue. But I still want to get a video done for this month, so what's an easy target I can bitch about for like 15 minutes? Oh, perfect. The casuals. Hey there. Welcome to the public disturbance I call a web show. And lately, I've been thinking about an increasingly controversial subject in gaming. Accessibility. Yes, I know. And the game that got me on this topic is an obscure little indie project by the name of Pokemon Let's Go. You probably haven't heard of it. On the surface, it's the same adorable, wholesome, family-friendly blood sport we've all come to know and love, but it's a game that is making a lot of longtime Pokefans nervous for future installments. For every step it takes towards improving the franchise, it stumbles backward about a mile and quickly stands up, pretending it totally meant to do that. It's the easiest game the franchise has ever produced, by far. It stripped away more than a decade of gameplay advancement and did very little to progress the series in any meaningful way beyond a few quality of life improvements here and there. It's also wildly successful and is one of the best-selling Switch games thus far, so it's really popular, but the fan reception is actually all over the place. So, what does this mean? Well, really, this whole controversy just embodies a debate that's been dominating the gaming zeitgeist since forever, and that is whether or not modern games are too easy or do too much hand-holding. At what point do games try to streamline themselves to the point that they're so easy they essentially play themselves? Why isn't everything like Dark Souls? Papa Miyazaki hurts my body so right. Look, not every game needs to be difficult, and the difficulty of games you prefer doesn't necessarily reflect your passion for gaming or anything like that. It just reflects your personal preference. Nothing more, nothing less. Before I go any further down that rabbit hole, I just want to say, I personally love challenge, usually. I love the Soulsborne games, I love playing Fire Emblem's hard modes, I try to go for max intensity in Smash Bros. Games, and one of my favorite RPG series is Shin Megami Tensei. And when I'm used to playing games like that, the concept of needing to simplify something like Pokemon is, quaint to me. But then I realized that's kind of a douchey mentality. Being good at games is a really shitty thing to be elitist about. Like, as a community, we don't even like it when competitive players do it, and if there's one group that has the right to be elitist, it's them. But at the end of the day, if you're tearing someone else down just to inflate your own ego, I don't really want you representing this culture, you know what I'm saying? Some people are new to games. Some people are only used to certain genres. Some people have slow reflexes or straight-up disabilities, and yeah, some people just kind of suck. But they all have the right to enjoy this medium. I guess what I'm trying to say is, while I enjoy difficult games and I want that difficulty to stay, I also want this medium to have as little gatekeeping as humanly possible. But how do you do that without removing the challenge that other players crave? Well, let's tackle one topic at a time. First off, accessibility does not have to be a bad thing. At all. I know a lot of gamers with every sort of taste you can possibly imagine, and while some of them want to play Ninja Gaiden while someone hits them in the crotch with a spiked baseball bat repeatedly, some of them just wanna, you know, chill out, and I can respect that. The Mass Effect trilogy eventually became a really good example of a nice compromise. It's a series that many people flocked to for its open-ended storytelling rather than its quote-unquote in-depth combat. So the developers decided to include a storyteller difficulty setting in order to make the game more accessible. The game certainly doesn't play itself, you still have to participate in the fights, because hey, those fights are still part of the narrative anyway. But the point is, it becomes more accessible without removing the appeal of the game to begin with. It's also entirely optional, so it's the kind of thing that makes everyone happy. Obviously, not every single game is well suited to implementing difficulty settings, but this is definitely something we could use more of. There's a lot of games I think could do with a storyteller mode. Now, getting back to that problem of elitism, playing at higher difficulty is something you can be proud of. but that doesn't mean playing at lower difficulty is something you should be shamed for. Both of those things are true at the same time. Everyone has their own level of skill and their own level of free time that they can invest into these things, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's why difficulty settings are so important. Case in point, I play Fire Emblem with permadeath and high difficulty and then just reset and play all the way from the beginning of a mission if I fuck up. Because that's what I find fun, apparently. Old school Fire Emblem fans are weird. But after years of brutal tradition, Fire Emblem Awakening came along and introduced some more casual difficulty settings to make the game more broadly accessible. And while there are definitely certain aspects of the newer games I'm not necessarily a fan of, the accessibility isn't something I really have a problem with. That's because the sense of challenge I enjoy is still available in these games. Accommodating for players who want a challenge is the other side of the accessibility coin. Again, not every game needs or even really can have difficulty settings, but as someone who's still waiting for a Kirby game that's actually difficult while maintaining all the series charm, I think more games could benefit from multiple levels of challenge. And that finally takes us back to Pokemon Let's Go, the game that very clickbaitingly started this whole topic to begin with. There's a lot of external reasons as to why it's such an intensely simplified version of Pokemon, but in the end, I think it's the quintessential example of why Pokemon especially needs different difficulty settings. This is something the franchise did exactly once, to my knowledge, and then never again, which seems to be a tradition when it comes to cool features in Pokemon games. Ultimately, while it's much more complicated than simply tweaking some numbers and variables here and there, I truly wish more games would just cater to everyone's taste and skill level. But there are some games where the difficulty is a more integral part of the experience. I could mention all those old-school NES platformers, but this is probably going to be controversial, but can we be real for a sec? A lot of these games are super difficult with a focus on trial and error for the sake of making them feel longer than they actually are. I mean, you can beat Mega Man 1 in less than 2 hours, even if you die a lot. Very often, the approach to their design is to throw a bunch of random chaos on screen and say, "Good luck, asshole." Now, don't get me wrong, these games are still fun, super influential, and very rewarding, but they come from a time where game design and balancing were a lot less polished and deliberate than it is now. In modern times, if a game is difficult, developers usually try their best to make that difficulty fair and organic. So I don't think difficulty is a super important, heavily deliberated aspect of these games so much as a way to add padding. Is that a super cynical viewpoint? Yeah, but shut up. Anyway, when it comes to games where the challenge actually enhances the intended experience, I can't think of a better example than Dark Souls. Yeah, I know, I'm a game journalist making a video about hard games, so I'm contractually obligated to mention Dark Souls or else the secret game police come after me in my sleep. I don't make the rules, I just follow them. Anyway, I'm sure a lot of you consider Dark Souls to be known as that franchise that's famous for one thing. Difficulty. Ball-bursting difficulty. And as much as the marketing team and even large parts of the community push that idea that the whole game just revolves around that difficulty, the series is much more than just mere challenge. The difficulty of Dark Souls is simply an integral part of its storytelling. Head developer Hidetaka Miyazaki has said in several interviews over several years that the difficulty in Dark Souls is not the main focus, it's just a small piece of the puzzle. He wants the player to feel accomplished for overcoming tremendous, terrifying odds. He wants to immerse the player in a foreboding, threatening situation. Dark Souls is a series about carving out a small fragment of hope in a hopeless world. It's about keeping the fire lit or finding a new way forward. And the challenge of facing these towering, deadly monsters and impossible odds is just one part of that cohesive theme. But here's a dilemma. If you implement an easy mode for Dark Souls, are you still getting the intended experience? Well, I'd argue no. That challenge and sense of danger is an integral aspect of the game's design, but On the flip side, there are a lot of people who would genuinely enjoy the world building and atmosphere of the game, but simply don't have the patience or the reaction time or the physical ability to deal with the more difficult moments. It's worth noting that most online polls suggest that the overwhelming majority of people who play Dark Souls games give up halfway through. Of course, that's not to say there aren't ways to make the Dark Souls games easier. Like, there are certain games where the difficulty setting is implemented in a more organic way, and Dark Souls itself is actually the perfect example of this. In every single Dark Souls game, there tends to be at least one or two playstyles that are much easier and less technically demanding than the others. In Dark Souls 1, it was sorcery. In Dark Souls 2, it was hybrid magic and archery to lure out enemies and fight them one at a time. And in Dark Souls 3, it's heavy armor and an even heavier weapon. This stuff doesn't necessarily apply to PvP, but it does make PvE a bit easier. These are powerful builds that certainly have some downsides associated with them, but are generally the least reliant on player skill. And I'm not hating on these playstyles at all. Power gaming your way through Dark Souls is a perfectly valid way of experiencing those games, you fucking casuals. But not every game is a big customizable action RPG, and not every game can offer a more organic solution to difficulty. This is why, in most cases, I think difficulty settings are a good idea. There are some games that are almost impossible to experience unless you meet a certain skill threshold, and while there will probably always be games that thematically and contextually benefit from that challenge, for a lot of games, especially the story-heavy ones and the ones that have a big sense of atmosphere and emphasize their world-building and such, accommodations can, and in my opinion, should be made. Because honestly, what's the downside in allowing more people to enjoy the greatest medium ever conceived? I certainly don't see why we shouldn't make gaming more accessible as long as sick masochists like me can also get our fix with some alternate, higher difficulty settings. Games are a medium that is inherently a little bit less accessible than other media. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't try to make accommodations for people who are interested in games, but for one reason or another just can't handle the difficult or challenging stuff. Or they just don't want to bother and have a relaxing experience. Either way, I think that desire is valid. In the end, while it's important to maintain the tradition of challenge, there's nothing wrong with introducing options and features to make things a little more accessible. I think we can all agree on that. Well, okay, this is YouTube, so someone is still going to find a way to be upset at something I said, but you know what I mean. Oh, and on that note, wave goodbye to this awkward closet that I'm never able to actually close, and that annoying ceiling fan thing that's usually in frame, because I'm actually getting the hell out of North Carolina forever. This is my last video here. I'm honestly really pumped about moving to a new, better location, living with some really awesome friends, and finally being in a more positive environment where I can focus on my work and health a lot more. But for now, I guess it's time to say goodbye to this era of EmceeProphIt. Goodbye, old house. Goodbye, unfinished wall that got damaged in the hurricane. Goodbye, Zimbabwe Bob, the hand-carved wooden giraffe from Africa. I honestly can't believe I never showed you off before. You're probably the coolest thing in this house, buddy. Goodbye, swamp that used to hold alligators, and hopefully doesn't anymore. Goodbye, Sophie. Nah, I'm just kidding. She's coming with me. That's my baby right there. Goodbye, shitty couch. And finally, last but not least, goodbye. Oh! Oh. Hey. Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed the show, please consider sustaining my fleeting existence by supporting me on Patreon. Even a buck per video really helps out. Thank you all so much for making this channel possible and helping me finally save up enough to move out and start a whole new chapter of EmceeProphIt. I'm gonna be real. I am finally gonna be able to work on the show as much as I want. No more major constant interruptions, at least for a while. And I am more excited than I can possibly express. But for now, know that I love you, and for one last time, get the hell out of my house.